So the main features I would distinguish the features by geography. And if I say geography, basically whether or not the farmer lives in the northern steady areas or in the south. So in the north, the main feature there is a focus more on crops that are also food, meant for food. So you have yam, which can be consumed as well as sold. You have rice, you have vegetables like onions in some areas. So that's for the north. When you come to the south, the main emphasis tends to be on non-food cash crops. It's not that they don't produce any food crops for sale. Of course, plantain is important in some of the areas. But the main emphasis, I mean, if you ask a farmer, what makes you a commercial farmer? The main thing he's likely to mention to you is because he's producing cocoa or oil palm or cashew or maybe some citrus, depending on the area you go.
Agricultural commercialization is not a new phenomenon in Ghana, a country that has had a long historical trajectory of commercial agriculture. However, the current interest in commercialization provides an opportunity to examine the differences among farmers in their experiences of commercialization and its contribution to their livelihood outcomes and well-being. Studies have pointed to differences in the experiences of farmers in southern Ghana as compared with their counterparts in the north, and between male and female farmers, and smallholder and medium-scale farmers across the country. In northern Ghana, agricultural commercialization has focused on the production of food crops, while the south is generally noted for export-oriented crops such as cocoa, cashew, and oil palm. The choices of these crops are not only influenced by climatic conditions, but also have been influenced by history and socioeconomic conditions. In both northern and southern Ghana, commercialization is not only increasing, but changing. One key feature of this change is the addition of a new stream of crops and the increased production of crops which were originally produced for household consumption. The demand for these new crops is thus increasing the interaction between farmers and markets, even if production is carried out on a small scale. These developments, which have complex interactions with land, labor, and capital, are highly gendered.
The more commercialized a farmer is, it means that he is selling most of the food crops that he produces, or the largest proportion of the food that they produce. So it means basically also that once a farmer decides which crop to produce, it's also made a commercialization decision. If you decide to produce cocoa, it means that you are a commercial farmer. If you decide to produce cashew, you are a commercial farmer, because you can't eat, you know, all your cashew, or you can't eat your cocoa at home. Commercialization provides an opportunity for farmers to make money. And you sell, you make money, and then you can purchase what you cannot produce yourself. So in that sense, commercialization is a very important means of making a living, because they raise money. They can invest in their children's education. One thing we noticed, especially in the cocoa areas, is that people sell their cocoa and they build new houses, or they change their roofs, or they convert their mud houses to brick or block houses. So these are all, you know, from proceeds of commercialization, right? So commercialization is extremely important for these smallholders when it comes to their livelihoods.
In the last 30 years that I can quite remember how I grew, people did only 1 to 5 acres for the upkeep of their families. Today, because of the emergence of the agri-value chains on crops, others are grabbing land that are exceeding 10 to 20 acres, be owned by one person, and incorporating machinery, equipment like tractors, combine harvesters, and what have you. These are basically associated with commercial agriculture. So I want to say commercial agriculture is being practiced, though it's at a slow pace, but who knows? In the next 2 to 3 years, it's possible that one farmer can buy at least the whole land of Garu, up to 200 or 300 hectares. It's still possible because of the interest that is coming up. So commercial agriculture is creeping in slowly.
Mi pia brochure bal mi hunse koko e wo Ghana no e staple crop nti no mi nso le bi ya ma dwen se me ba bi dua koko no bi pa nti me ba pen 8 years ni na maye koko koko be ye 40 acres ah amam fogo nti se ma fu mu ana me fi be.
We have something we call staff loan. They will give you, ask you to come and take the loan for 3 months. And then I'll go and take the 3 months salary advance. Then I'll plow that wine into my farming. And before you realize, an articulator is sitting in my house to convey my corn at the end of the year. And when I go and sell that in bulk, my brother, the money is huge. So when the money is huge, what do I do with it? And I make sure that we had all plantable things, things that you don't need to go and buy them in the market. Like I'm talking to you, we plant pepper, we plant okra, and we make sure that all the dry season, we have a vegetable garden, and then we don't buy all those things. We go into onions cultivation, we don't buy those things. There are things that are going to pick your small manners away. And then I am in livestock, in poultry. I don't buy meat. If I open my fridge now, you see the fridge is full. It's just here. The fridge is full of meat. Slaughter, sometimes even a cow. And we are sitting there eating. So we don't spend on the salary.
The new paradigm of smallholder agriculture, which is also tied to this AGOA scheme, is that new crops are becoming commercialized, especially food crops. Cassava is the best example. Today, cassava is used for beer.
Medium-scale farmers are especially interesting because they are often Ghanaians who have been working in other sectors of the economy over a long period of time and have accumulated resources from those sectors, and they have plowed it into agriculture. And they basically show what possibilities there are for small-scale farmers if they get the needed support. It suggests that if small-scale farmers get improved access to land and they get support with inputs and credit and other facilities, they are likely to move into medium-scale farming, and that will be very good for the agricultural landscape. And it is imperative that if we decide to put in place policies to support the growth of medium farmers, that we ensure that women are also supported to become medium farmers. Because one of the unfortunate observations we have made in the agricultural sphere is that when households move from small-scale farming to medium-scale farming, and they begin to use hired labor, women get out of farming because they are not able to get the land to farm on such a scale. So they move out into other economic activities. If we want more women to remain in farming, we have to support them in ways that ensure that they remain in agriculture.